Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick. Still here in North Carolina for a couple more weeks. Anyway, I just want to say praise God. I have a viewer actually that's here just 10 minutes away from me. So praise God for that. I think that's the first person that's from the same place I am, I guess, that I'll be meeting with. So praise God for that. Brothers and sisters, I just want to tell you, I'm going to probably title this about going up there to the Northwest. You know, the reason why I made the plan to go to the Northwest, brothers and sisters, is because at least three or four times the Lord has spoken to me about going to Seattle. And I know that there's people who have been inviting me to Portland and into Vancouver. So, you know, by the grace of God, they're all pretty close, actually. Like 3 hours to each one from, say, Seattle. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I just want to give a praise report and glory to God because the Lord just spoke to me again tonight. That he told me that he had many people in Seattle. Many people in Seattle. So I'm excited because I know the Lord's going to do something. And that's what I wanted to tell you guys. You know, whenever I make these videos and talk about these things, I always, you know, think about it. Applying it into your life. And into your, when you try to do something for the Lord. Because the Lord will give us an instruction, brothers and sisters. He will give us an instruction. And then our blessing is in that instruction. When the Lord gives you an instruction, he's setting you up to be blessed. He's setting you up for, you know, someone to get saved. And in the process of someone getting saved, someone getting delivered, or many people saved, many people delivered, he's also going to bless you. That's how God operates. Brothers and sisters, you have to be in the right place at the right time with the right people. I just made a video the other day. I've loaded a two. There's another one I'm going to load. This is kind of building on that one. And I haven't loaded that video because I'm not really sure what I was saying in it. You know, because I was just giving general information about revival. And this is the point. It's like if you take a fish. I've mentioned this before. If you take a fish, brothers and sisters, and lay that fish on the ground, take it out of the water, it's going to be useless. It's going to die. As a matter of fact, the fish is useless. It can't do anything. But if you take that fish and put it in the water, that fish is in its element. It's in the right place at the right time. As a matter of fact, if you took a salt, let me just take it, you know, break it down even more. If you took a saltwater fish and put it in fresh water, it would kill it. If you took a freshwater fish and put it in salt water, it would kill it. With the only exception being, you know, maybe salmon when they go to spawn, you know. But, you know, that's a reference to going to the Northwest too, brothers and sisters. Going up to the Northwest part of the United States where they have the salmon runs and all that. Anyway, you know, it's not, and this is what I talked about in that video that I'm going to load, maybe before or after this one. It's, you know, you can take any method, these methods that worked someplace, like this G12. I don't know if you guys heard of that. In the Philippines, all the preachers are trying to do this G12, where you have, you know, each person has their own 12 disciples, and then each of those people, they have their own 12 disciples. It's like a multi-level marketing thing. And I read some of the writings of the guy who started it. And this guy, it's like somewhere in Guatemala or somewhere, I forgot, Venezuela or somewhere. He was saying if you don't have exactly 12, you know, it won't work. You know, and it becomes like a magic formula. It's just like, as I mentioned all the time, this evangelism explosion that was started by Dr. D. James Kennedy. These different methods that churches will teach in Sunday school or whatever, they'll get on a kick of let's do this technique, this technique. When you hear people who've been to those classes, it's like a Jehovah's Witness or something. You know, it's plastic. It's like a broken record. They're just repeating and babbling, you know, what they heard. So it's like this, brothers and sisters. Like take yourself, for instance. And like myself, when I first started out or when you first learn those Bible verses. You say, hey, I want to learn the Roman road. If you're a Christian and you don't know what's the Roman road, that's what I'm saying. You're not meat for the master's use. You're not usable by the Lord if you do not know the basic Bible verses. As Peter told us, be prepared, you know, to give an answer or, you know, to give an argument for the faith that lies within you, for the hope that lies within you. You should be prepared to give a response when people say, how do you know you're going to heaven? How do you know you're saved? If you can't do that, how can you be saved if you can't even tell someone that you know you're saved? And this is how you know you're saved. Give some Bible references, Bible verse references, If you can't do that, how in the world did you ever get saved? It shocks me always of the lack of knowing the Bible that there is in the body of Christ. That is going to be the Bible says, my people perish because of lack of knowledge. And that, brothers and sisters, is really what's causing this falling away in the church. These false leaders, you talk about false prophets, the leaders of the Presbyterian USA and all that, voting in that gay marriage and homosexuality is not a sin, just yesterday or today, all of these things going on. Those are false prophets. Everybody talking about false prophet on YouTube, those are real false prophets who really have an impact on millions of people, leading them into damnation in hell with false doctrine. But the people, if they knew their Bible and believed the Bible was from God and it was the Word of God, the infallible Word of God, and they believed that and then read it and believed it, then of course they wouldn't fall for that foolishness. Anyway, brothers and sisters, you have to be in the right time at the right place with the right people. And then when you get that, say, as I mentioned, the Roman road down pat, you memorize those Bible verses. You know, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. There's none righteous, no, not one. You know, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. If we confess with our mouth and believe in our heart that Jesus Christ is Lord and God has raised him from the dead, that shall be saved. All who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. When we learn some of these Bible verses, and then, you know, we say them, and when we're new, brothers and sisters, even like myself, you know, you're just trying to say the Bible verse right. You're like a robot. You're trying to, you know, you're just trying to regurgitate what you've learned. And that's how it is when you're new, and that's normal. But as Jesus said, you know, don't take no thought of what you're going to say. Because, you know, the Holy Spirit, God, the Holy Spirit will lead you in what to say. When that moment comes, the Lord himself will lead and guide you by his Spirit. For those who are led by the Spirit, these are the sons of God. Another Romans verse. Romans chapter 8, verse 14. For those who are led by the Spirit, these are the sons of God. So we need to be led by the Holy Spirit. What to say, when to say. As an example, brothers and sisters, there are people who get saved when they hear about the love of Christ. Oh, you know, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever shall believe in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. Some people get saved when they find out that they need to get saved, when they find out they're lost. When you say somebody, oh, you need Jesus to save you, they'll, you know, these, especially, you know, maybe some young people, ha, 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 yeah, Jesus saved me. Save me from what? Why do I need Jesus to save me? See, they don't have the realization, and it's not real to them. They don't believe. They probably heard about hell. They think it's a joke. They think it's funny. They think it's something to mock. But when the Holy Spirit convicts their heart that God's not joking, hell's still smoking, that hell is real, that eternal damnation and separation from God and being tormented in the flames of fire whose smoke goes up forever and ever before the throne of the Lord, when you would speak those words to the right people in the right time in the right place, it brings a conviction of the Holy Spirit. That's why we have to be led by the Spirit. God knows exactly what each person needs to hear to get saved. Is it about hell? Is it about the love of God? Do they need to see somebody get healed? Do they need to see an answered prayer? Do they need their own selves to be healed? Do they need their own prayers answered? What is it that they need? What is it, the revelation of the Lord they need to get that would lead them to say, hey, I need to be saved. I need to be born again. I need the Lord Jesus Christ to be the Lord and Savior of my life. That is the thing that only God knows, brothers and sisters. You can guess and speculate all day long. And I want to tell you this from experience, brothers and sisters. And I don't even have any idea what the count is. I've led thousands of people to the Lord one-on-one. I've done lots of mass crusades, and I prayed with thousands and thousands of people one-on-one, brothers and sisters. And you can never judge a book by its cover. You never know. You're not supposed to, even as God told Samuel about King David, because King David was a little runt, you know, the youngest of Jesse's sons. And Jesse had like seven sons, and he had some older sons that were really good looking. And the prophet Samuel thought, well, surely this is God's anointed, because God told Samuel, go there to this house of Jesse in Bethlehem, and I'm going to anoint one of his sons to be king over Israel, and he's going to be a man after my own heart. And Samuel, you know, said, oh, surely this is God's anointed. And God said, no, you're judging according to the flesh. I judge after a man's heart. So David was chosen by God for what was in his heart. See, so it was the opposite of what Saul thought. Just like Jesus was born in a manger. The opposite of what the world would say about a king and where a king would be born, brothers and sisters. So therefore, brothers and sisters, we must be led by the Spirit of God if we want to do God's will and go forward in what God wants us to do, brothers and sisters.